Go over to the pick and bound screen, aka the in-game client. Alright, did you run the commercials, Zoya, when we
I
were
did.
Supposed to run commercials? Awesome.
I did.
You were so good at this.
I am going to make a request of the other casters, so I'm going to go ahead and mute myself so I can type.
Mute yourself. I'll talk about the picks and bans. We have a ban out here for Falstad and a ban on Stitches. The first pick is going to be Uther. So, ban on Falstad, a really smart choice out here from Strekton Ice. They were scared of FaZe Falstad, and that was a very good thing to be scared of. Because, for the most part, FaZe Shock and Awe was doing so much work in that last game, as well as the first game as well. And that's...
Wait, picks and bans already started?
Yes. Geez, Zoya!
Who was the first ban?
First Falstad. Ban was oh. Falstad, because they were afraid of Faye. Ban on Stitches good. From Idra for Snowflake, and that's, I think, a really good choice as well.
Tassa Noob. Oh, letting Idra play Tassadar is going to be so scary. His Tassadar is so much damage that Archon we saw in game number one was just decimating. Unfortunately, just not enough to turn the tides, but they do have that Anubarak. So to see what the next two picks are. Are we going to see that Arthas Kerrigan? That's what I'm thinking, man. Arthas Kerrigan.
Arthas Kerrigan?
Arthas Kerrigan from Team Strekton Ice.
How much you want to bet? Over, under, $5. I don't know. I don't know about Arthas Kerrigan. I'm hoping they don't
I'm just
do
putting my mindset
Avatar.
Into Strekton Ice. I'm going into Strekton... Ooh, that's right. The Avatar is a high priority pick for them. I'll
but on like- Haunted Minds...
See, I disagree with people. I don't think Haunted Mind is Abathur's worst map.
I mean, it might not be his worst map, but it's definitely not strong for him. And I don't think Abathur would be a really
well,
good
Well, I don't think Abathur really has bad maps. Like, I think he's just that good of a hero now. Like, I don't look at a map and go, well, you can't pick Abathur here. Abathur players have gotten so good that they can make him work well on almost any map.
That's true. We'll see.
Like... The best team in the world, SMG, frequently enjoys taking Abathur on Haunted Mines.
Yeah.
From what Dreadnought was telling me.
They're taking a bit of time to think about this. They got the Uther.
Arthas Kerrigan, man. Calling it. Calling it right now.
But who are they going to sub in for that Abathur? I really don't think that they're going to pick Abathur for this map.
This just in. We will be casting Winner's Finals.
Woot!
That was what I was requesting of the other casters.
Oh, okay. Yeah, guys, I don't think we're going to be casting the Grand Finals just because there are two pairs of casters. Unfortunately, this is my fault that we're not going to be casting those Winners Finals because I have to go to...
He's got a trip.
I've got to go to Columbus, Ohio for all of next week. So I'm actually flying out tomorrow, so I got to get some stuff done before I go.
Yeah.
Pick Tychus Abathur.
The Tychus is really weird.
Damn it!
We were both wrong.
Tychus!
That's an interesting choice. Tychus is obviously a good hero, and we've seen Snowflake use them both games. We haven't seen Strekton Ice using any carries yet, though. Range carry. So I'm curious to see how Mongol is going to play on Tychus and how they synergize with that as well.
Yeah.
What do you think we're going to see here from Snowflake? We already got the Anubarak and Tassadar. Do you think... Well, Arthas Nova.
Okay, that's solid. I haven't seen, actually, Snowflake bust out a Nova yet.
Well,
now, what I have seen is I've seen Snowflake be incredibly afraid of Nova. I watched a couple of matches where they were playing against a Nova, and it seemed like and every time there was a snipe, everybody flinched on Snowflake. I don't know if they've realized how to deal with Nova, or maybe they're just like, you know what, beat your fears by playing the character.
Well, I've been playing a lot with Faye, and Faye's Nova is like anything Faye plays with a skill shot is disgusting.
Yeah, I can see that, especially with her shock and alls from last game.
I can see Faye's Nova doing really well.
So between Faye's Falstad and her Nova, which is her final form?
Tyranda, man. Have you seen her Tyranda? Her Tyranda just...
I haven't seen her Tyranda.
Chills down my spines. Like, she tops damage while being just, like, landing every skill shot. It's disturbing. Like, Like, to look at that and know you'll never be that good, it makes you want to cry.
Soya, you're only admitting that you're ever never going to be that good only makes you never that good.
I guess that's true. I should have a more positive mind. I can be better than Faye. She's not that great.
Right? There. Well, okay, we don't have to go and, like,
Don't go full ham, okay.
Just say, you know what? It would take a lot of practice and time for me to be that good as Tyrande. There we go. Ready? Uplifting. So we still have that Arthas Nova. We're still waiting for the fourth and fifth pick out here from Shrekt on Ice.
I think if Shrekt on Ice wants to snipe a hero, they should take Rhaegar. Because I think Snowflake is wanting to take Rhaegar. Most definitely here. I don't see Malfurion working well as a support. And I really don't like Brightwing in this situation. I kind of want to think it'll be Rhaegar. If it's going to be something else, it will be Brightwing.
I don't know about that, my friend. I think actually a Brightwing would be... Wait, hold on. We're talking about Shrek
against the current picks. No, for Snowflake picks. Snowflake would. I think they're going to take Rhaegar over Brightwing.
I think a Brightwing would actually be a really good addition.
Well,
to
look
their
at
team.
The with the current picks. It's just Tychus, Abathur, Uther. Like, that's not something you really want. That's not something that demands a Brightwing. Like, none of those are high priority polymorph targets. None of that's like super Emerald Windy. With the Archon, you get the Bloodlust. That also helps with the Arthas as well as the Anubarak. Or if they choose to go the heal.
That's true.
Oh, maybe, though. Brightwing would also... I don't know.
I think Brightwing could be pretty good. It depends on how they want to play her. But at the same time,
I mean,
getting
two picks as well.
Getting the Emerald Wind and suppressing the Tychus... Like, it doesn't even have to be the Polymorph. Just using the Emerald Wind to push the Tychus away and not allow him to shoot, I think would actually be really good for them.
Yeah. So I'm sticking at Kerrigan. We've seen a lot of Kerrigan today, and they lack some hard initiate. I'm thinking Kerrigan and...
What did I say 3 minutes ago that was very professional?
I don't know. I saw that too, and I forgot.
I'm seeing
as well.
Chat blow up about it. And yeah. That's the worst thing about this, is like I'm trying to remember, what did I say 3 minutes ago?
I don't remember. I don't remember. In 3 minutes, we'll see when they remind us, if anyone else remembers. I'm thinking Kerrigan... Like, what warrior do you... Like, maybe Chen? Or a Tyrael? Maybe Kerrigan Tyrael is, like... Because Abathur with Chen... With Kerrigan Tyrael, Tychus, Uther, Abathur. I think that's a really good comp. I think Tyrael and Kerrigan would be good picks here for them. Based off what they've been playing and what we know of them.
I don't know about Tyrael. They need something a little bit more tanky. They need something to block for that Tychus.
Yeah, but I really, like, when you look at more tanky things, like, it's either Chen, who is tanky, but he's more of, like, a weird bruiser tank. Like, he just gets in your face. So that leaves Diablo and ETC, and I don't really like either of those in this comp.
Yeah.
Like, neither of those synergize well. Like, I guess you can try and do Divine Storm Apocalypse, but that's really it. Like, I mean, ETC, no, definitely not him. I mean, this is why they're taking so long to pick. Like, they're in such an awkward position. Okay, I'm done. The cast is over. See you guys tomorrow. GG.
If this isn't...
ETC Muradin, are you serious?
Wait. Actually...
No, Kev. Stop.
That could
no,
work.
Actually.
That could
no,
work.
No, actually.
That could
no.
work.
No. Maybe if they
no 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 no
double
Soya, shut your stupid mouth for 5 seconds. I'm kidding. Think about it. Like, you have two people that are really good at displacing and stunning, like Muradin and Jesus. I'm sorry. After Dino last time said that concludes the draft phase after beating Snowflake. Idja just in all caps yells, "That concludes the draft phase. Ready." So Idja turning the meta around on Dino. That was really nice. So anyway, we see the Muradin ETC. This actually has legitimacy.
Maybe if he goes Haymaker and they do cheeky stuff with that.
No, not even that. You just put two bodies in front of a Tychus. You have the Abathur clone the Tychus. You have double Odin. with two really tanky, disruptive and stun heavy heroes in front, and you just kind of run this 2x2x1 kind of like formation, and I think it could actually work. So we're getting into the game.
The problem with this is it's Haunted Mines, which, like, you have level 3, level 4 team fights in the mines. So I don't see the ETC Muradin combo working out well against how much damage Snowflake has early on.
It's possible. We will see. So who's on the left and who's on the right?
We'll find out. Snowflake's
oh, wow. The They've always been on the left. This is awesome for...
I think it might be chosen by... who hosts the game? I don't know. Let's get some introductions going here. On the blue side of the map, we have Team Snowflake, Idra on Tassilar, Keelax on Malfurion, LZ Gamer on Anubarak, Faye on Nova, and Chilotech on the Arthas.
And over here, in the red trunks, it's Trekt on Ice, coming to a theater near you on Sundays, with Phoenix on Uther, Mongol on Tychus, Xyferia playing ETC Muradin, the dwarf warrior being played by Dino. And where's that Abathur? He's sneaking around. There it is. There's Stoles. Kind of shrugging back and forth. He's kind of walking like with his dongers up all right now. He's kind of doing the Heimerdinger walk. He's kind of like getting that shrug back and forth with the shoulders. Anyway, everybody's coming out onto the map. They're doing some fun stuff. We got four people up top to push with the Grave Golem out here for Snowflake. And bottom lane is pretty barren here for Shrek on Ice.
Well, here we go. Chiltex does land the root on Dino. He is going to get rooted by Malfurion as well. Big knockup from Elza Gamer. Going to land the forward thrust as well and ends up getting that kill. Zephira going to have to back off, but we do see that Chiltex ends up dying as well. One for one. We have in the bottom lane that pass over to the Abathur lane.
Oh, the entangling root's going to actually let an ETC get killed as well. This is actually not too good out here for Shrek on Ice, giving up the double early blood.
Any advantage on Haunted Mines is a good one. Everyone goes straight for the mines at about 3 minutes in the game.
Yeah.
You're level 3, you want to be level 4 by then, and the advantage that Snowflake has, will they be able to carry that on?
Well,
that's
about the
actually pushing pretty hard, but...
Let's talk about the late game. Actually, let's talk about the early game right now. Abathur puts a really big disadvantage on Shrek on Ice, I would say, at this point. Because they're not going to have five bodies available in the mines. They're going to have four bodies and a hat.
Yeah. I mean, Abathur's got great damage, though. So it's not the end of the world. We'll just have to see how they utilize that. We have mines beginning in 10 seconds. We actually do have the standard 130 timing for those giants. For Team Shrek on Ice. Snowflake not doing the same, and we're seeing Snowflake stat for top lane, Shrek on Ice stacking for the bottom lane. Snowflake going to be the first to get their whole team inside, though. We'll have to see when that team fight actually happens.
Now, the only thing I can think about is that the advantage that you get from Abathur is that every time everybody's in the mines, you get free pushing with the Locust.
Yep, and the experience as well. Snowflake is at level 4 right now. They want to wait for four, so best to get those time. But Dino actually getting way up here right now. Chiltech not landing a root on anyone. The Malfurion roots does not hit anybody as well. Snow does land on Phoenix. Abathur is on ETC. He's in the back line, do as much damage as possible. But there is like no damage. They only have the Tychus and Abathur for damage right now. They want to make a play happen, but they can't. And they're on full retreat. Root does miss. LZ Gamer goes in. It's a big stun on all three. When Phoenix gets stunned as well, he's gonna fall. Dino is at the front. Big storm right now. Another knockup on Dino. Will he be able to get out? He goes for the leap and he does make it out. One kill. And Muradin, his last hit, will he get away? He does. Chiltech not able to secure that. And now Snowflake has free reigns in the mine. They're at 24 skulls right now, and they're going to be able to get a lot more.
Oh my god. I don't know if you know this, but it's absolutely hilarious. When you put everything on low for lighting, everybody becomes a ball of light in the mine. And so everybody was just glowing. All I could see were health bars and names.
Oh my god. ETC just barely getting away. Dino's pretty low as well. But Mongol and Phoenix coming up from above. Faye and Keelax a little bit of opposition. LZ Gamer from behind. And Dino and Mongol are in a lot of trouble. If this collapse happens from LZ from behind, Dino trying to secure this kill on Faye. The heal does go down from Malfurion. Trying to kite back, and Faye will be able to get out of there. Phoenix being chased. The poison does go down, and another kill. And so many kills right now. 5-1 in favor of Team Snowflake. Skulls are 47-17.
If Mongol is able to get out of there. Okay, so The big thing about this team from Shrek on Ice is that they really take advantage of things that don't have escapes. So, Kilex as well as Faye, they're two big, heavy members of Snowflake because they don't have any escapes at all. They're trying to take advantage of that, using that Muradin, trying to get in, trying to stunlock Faye and get that Nova kill. Unfortunately, just because Snowflake was just floating around at that time, it didn't really work out. I really like the fact that Snowflake is leaving the Golem, and just, they already have 53 skulls, they can just go start dealing with everything else. It's whether or not they're going to actually be able to come in here and make something happen on these knights.
Well, they are going to cap them right now. Chilchick not able to lay that, the root does. Actually, LTK is in there last second, but the knights are here, and the big root goes down, it's hitting Dino, he's getting so low in HP, the knockback does happen, LZ wants to go for that kill so bad. Idra, will he be able to land a storm? The poison does go down on Zephyria, he's going to try and back out here, he's out of mana, does not have room for dash, the slow does go down, the storm hits him as well, doing a lot of damage. Faye wants to get in range for that snipe, misses the snipe on Dino, Dino's going to be able to leap away, get healed by Phoenix, and no kills going over there, and Snowflake, a lot of them went back, and they're going to go back into mines for that Golem. If they can get a Grave Golem, that's going to be a 83 skull golem. Making sure my math's right. Yeah, 83 skull golem. That's a huge golem. They have level 7. Both teams having level 7. But here they come. They are coming in. They are going straight for this grave golem. Vegas leaped on.
Yeah, Dino now coming in here does get the stuns and is absolutely able to obliterate Faye. This is going to allow them to get a golem that's going to be at least comparable to the golem of Snowflake, and actually they could turn this around to be a pretty big advantage because the lane that the golem's going to be pushing has been pushed by Abathur this entire time. And you know what that means, Gazoya? It means that if there's not too many shots on these towers as soon as the golem does spawn, as well as the fact that the gate is down, that golem's going to do a lot more work on the bottom lane for Shrek on Ice than it is going to be doing favors for Snowflake on the top lane.
Dude, I'm seeing like the rebroadcast on my second monitor, and like, you're right, those balls of light
are they insane. Are massive. Dude, balls like of beacon. Light, it's hilarious.
Wow, that's, I see chat, my eyes are burning. Oh, wow. And this is something smart that Snowflake's doing. They kill the giants, but they're not capping them right away. They're making sure they have the giants ready to help defend against the Grave Golem, because they are going to be pushing top lane as a team. They want the Giants to help delay that push to do as much damage to the Grave Golem while they push top. We'll have to see if Arthas and Faye end up swinging up. Faye does have hot shots now. Hot shots on Nova is when Nova starts getting really scary.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to start seeing that damage explode from her. And we have a big push. 53 Skull Golem. We have Team Shrek on Ice here to defend.
Yeah, and you know, I'm really glad that you mentioned that's when Nova gets good, because for the most part, a lot of the Shrek on Ice members, they don't really get good until a little bit later on in the game. Now, Tychus is always a really strong pick until about level 10, but Muradin really starts getting really good once he gets that rewind, once he gets, you know, his either Dwarf Toss or Heavy Impact. And we're going to have to wait until that point, until Shrek on Ice is going to be in a really confident position. As well as with Abathur, I mean, it's also going to be... This is actually a really strong late-game team. Until then, it looks like Snowflake's going to be in a really dominating position, using this Grave Golem really well, and look at just how much damage they're doing with it. But at the same time, look at the one at bot lane here for Shrek on Ice. It's already done way more damage to the fort.
Yeah, because Abathur keeps symbioting it, and it's really helping push that. Finally symbioting the top fort. Will Snowflake be able to get this? It depends on which fort falls first. They will get level 10. Maybe bomb won't fall. And actually, big kill there. Uther going to get evaporated as it gets stunned. LZ Gamer coming straight in. Level 10 is here for Snowflake. Will they be able to capitalize on this? No level 10. The fort did not fall for Shrek on Ice. They wanted to get that bottom fort, and they weren't able to do it. The Giants, they won that lane for them. Mm-hmm. It's such a smart play there from Snowflake.
But again, I mean, look at how much left is on that fort. That could have gone so much worse for Shrek on Ice, especially because they didn't push with that lane at all. But by letting that Abathur just kind of AFK push that lane with the Locusts, this is almost the same amount of an advantage for Shrek on Ice. As long as they can just get in there, get a couple of taps, and take out that fort, they're going to be in the same position. Now, as long as they can actually stop this push from Snowflake is the question. Level 10 has come out here for both these teams. They have all their ults. Nothing really too crazy coming out from either of these teams, though.
Yeah, we do see the expected tranquility.
Oh, actually, everything. There is something really weird. There's an avatar on that Muradin.
Yeah, why didn't you go Haymaker, man? That thing's so cool.
Well, I believe they just recently nerfed Haymaker just a little bit. It's got a little bit more of a wind-up right now. It's about half a second wind-up. And yeah, it's actually, like, makes it really easy to get out of range or stop it.
Fort is going to fall here in bot lane. Will either team be willing to force an engagement before the mines? We actually have Knight spawning in 6 seconds. That's where the next team fight is going to be. We have Snowflake already in a party bush here. And they, Helix is actually visible, unfortunately. Oh. Indra going to go straight into Archon mode. Root does hand Big Stone on Zephyria. Dino coming in with an Avatar here. Avatar not willing to use that turn right away. Big Nova Precision Strike here, doing a lot of damage to Zephyria. Showtek using that army. Mogul is about to lose that Odin, and it does fall, and he's getting bursted down by that Archon. He gets a back right, and Dino is so tanky with that Avatar, but will they be able to secure the kill? The Root does land, and he's definitely going down. 3-4-0 in favor of Snowflake. The mine spawn in 24 seconds. Everyone will be able to be alive for Strecked Off Ice, but they will be, Snowflake will already be in the mines.
And that's a really scary moment right now, is that, you know, they're still waiting for their team to start getting the momentum that they need, but on a map like Haunted Mines, I mean, we see SMG end games at 8 minutes really easily just because they get that dominating early game, and I think that's something that Strecked On Ice kind of overestimated, that they were going to be A-okay to get through everything and be okay through dealing with the mines while they got into that situation where they're going to be able to deal with stuff later on in the game. Because Haunted Mines, if you don't have that early game presence, if you don't have the really strong early game, you're going to be in a really difficult position. Already we see that the fort at bot lane is getting really pressured by Snowflake for Strecked On Ice. If they lose that other fort, that's going to be two forts down.
Well, fight is going to happen at this golem over here. Avathur already ulting onto that Uther. Will they be able to win this fight here? Right now, Snowflake has the skull advantage. If Snowflake wins this Grave Realm, it's going to be huge. Dino immediately getting focused right down. He does have to leap out of there. Precision Strike landing on that entire team. Big stun from Shultek. He's going to slow them all down. LZ Gamer coming in from behind. Faye trying to get into position to snipe someone. And looks like the Avatar clone doesn't find him. Now it's suddenly a 5v4. And everyone on Snowflake is just full HP. There is no damage at all on this Strecked On Ice team. And they are going to easily take this Grave Realm. 76 skulls.
Yeah, they get all of them. Really, I'm so curious as to why they keep cloning Uther over everybody else. I can understand a double Divine Storm, but they just don't have any damage without having a second Tychus. I mean, Tychus is good, Tychus is strong, but you need another Tychus. You need another, ranged hero to really do the damage that you need to do.
I'm going to take this time. I got an update for you, Kev.
What's up?
2 Arc Iliad, 2-0 Glorious Gaming.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a bit of an
That is a pretty big upset. So the winner of this game will be playing 2 Arc in the winner's finals of the winner's bracket, guys. Not the grand finals, just the winner's bracket finals. Now we have 76 goals here for Snowflake. They're going to be pushing top lane as a team. Let's take a look at those heroics real quick. Everything is up except for Army of the Dead. It's got 19 seconds on it, so
They can survive not doing anything just yet. I mean, that weak golem's gonna get taken out by creeps alone. As well as the siege giants are gonna be able to help take out all the creep coming out here from Strecked On Ice. Snowflake is really in a really strong advantage position right now. Whether or not they're gonna get the team fight that they want. Dino did get snared, but did jump out of it. They're hoping to chain those snares in there and possibly get a grab on Dino, but it doesn't look like it's gonna happen. Stoll's now going to be cloning that Tychus, and it looks like this might be an engagement that could go in favor of Strecked On Ice. They have the defender's advantage, they have double Tychus, as long as their warriors can get the engagement and really kind of be the giant wall in front of their double Tychus.
As you're looking for the storms, they're wanting to get this engage here. That mule is helping a lot. Keep is half HP. Will Snowflake be willing to engage? It does not look like it. Keelex running into a few Avatar bombs there, and the mule, it's got a bit of aggression and maybe be able to get a little over half of them. Here comes Dino coming in. Avatar does go down. Storm do a lot of damage to him. There goes the first Odin. Will we see the second one from Mogul? Souls running out of time on that Avatar clone. Here the healing ward doing a lot there. Precision Strike doing a lot of damage. That's a huge mosh pit though, hitting 4 people. Shultek getting pretty low, but he's already back to full health. And the damage is just not there. Even with a 4-person mosh pit, they weren't able to kill a single person. One ETC is down. Uther's down. Mongol is getting low damage, but he does fall from the slide. Dino being chased here. Will Shultek be able to secure the kill? He won't be able to. The keep's gonna fall. We have 30 seconds until anyone's up. Will Snowflake be able to end it here? Will they be able to take this fort? They're definitely gonna try.
And I mean, that's really like the biggest issue there, is that Mongol did use that Odin, I guess a little bit afraid of whether or not Snowflake was going to be engaging earlier on in that fight when the golem came in, and Manga uses his Odin very early. They didn't focus down Keelex. The Tranquility was going on during the mosh pit, and they just, with that mosh pit going on and the Tranquility healing absolutely everybody, they didn't seem like they were focusing anybody down. It seemed like it was just very distributed damage against everybody on Snowflake, and Tranquility completely counters that.
Yeah, that was wow. After that first game, man, it looked like they had a chance. But game two and three, I mean, that was kind of more what we would expect from Snowflake. But, you know, if they made, I mean, they should have made fans of any, like, people today. Like, they try weird things. They made them work one game. They tried something new this game three, and it didn't quite work out for them. Yeah. But it was their first tournament appearance. They're not out of the tournament just yet. They're just knocked into the loser's bracket. Snowflake's going to move on to the winner's finals, where they will play two Arc Iliad to try and another, I believe winner's finals is also.